best way I can describe it is it asked me whether I wanted to stay or go. It wasn't human though. I mean, it wasn't like, wow, Chris, I really feel bad that you tried to kill yourself. That is so sad. Oh, poor Chris. It wasn't that. And it wasn't like, damn you, Chris, I can't believe you tried to kill yourself. There was no judgment whatsoever. It was just absolutely stare go. And it was a feeling. It was instant, just a feeling, like a question, like I was being asked without any language. And I knew what it meant. And I immediately thought, stay. If I could have closed my eyes, I would have. If I could have clenched my fist, I would have. And I would have said, stay. Yes, I want to live. I want to live. I don't want to die. I don't want to die. And immediately, all of a sudden, that whole turned into, and I could feel the air. I could feel this pain, like unbelievable pain in my body. I was in this clammy, constricted, small, painful space. I could not see. I could not talk. And all I could hear was this loud helicopter and wind coming through. So there was like a window open. And just pain, 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 pain. And I thought, oh my God, I'm never going to be able to drive again. They're going to take my license because I was on a second suspended DUI when I hit the bus. And the next thought was, I'm going to live. And a feeling from my toes started creeping up from my toes to my calves, my ankles, my knees, my thighs, my hips, my stomach, my chest, my shoulders, my arms, my head. This feeling of peace and serenity and calm, love just enveloped me. And I had no pain. I went back to sleep. I passed out. I came to a little later and I saw some red light, and I was trying to lift my head up and some guy kept pushing my head back down. And he's like, you want to be able to walk, don't you? And I was like, yes. And he's like, don't move your head. And then I went back out again. And from the police report that we got, the helicopter was on its way to Hospital A. And Hospital A wasn't equipped to handle a surgery or anything emergency like that. And some point during the Hospital A path that the helicopter was on, a nurse or somebody somewhere in the chain of things realized that that hospital wasn't going to be able to save me. And at some point they made that call and said, divert, 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 go to the other one. And at that point, the helicopter turned and went to Hospital B, which saved my life. And I believe to this day that had I say no, it would have gone to the first one. But I said yes, and for some reason, something saved me. Came to with a bunch of tubes, and all I could hear was doop, doop, doop. These tubes were stuck in, all this stuff was just stuck inside me, and I was in pain. I was in the hospital bed laying back, and I looked over, and there was Jeffrey Wilson. I don't know how long I had been out. Might have been the fourth, fifth day, something like that. But he had found out I was in a wreck somehow. Somebody called him somehow. And he made it to the hospital bed, and he was on my side at the bed, sitting there with his snakeskin boots and his legs crossed and his LA Lakers hat on and jersey and flipping through a magazine. And he looked at me. I was like, Jeff, wow. And he goes, you can't even kill yourself, right? Just flipping through the magazine. I was like, oh my God, what's going to happen? They're going to take my license. He goes, don't worry about your license. You're going to worry about jail. You're going down, man. Those cops want to get you, man. They're writing on that report. Did you see the report? They're calling this an intended action, an intended event. You're going to jail. So we're going to get you ready for it. It's either jail or the psych ward. And I was like, oh my God. I thought my life was bad before. But now I completely ruined everything. And he said, jail or the psych ward? Don't worry, we'll smuggle you cigarettes if you go to jail. And you know what I mean? If you go to the psych ward, well, that's going to be a lot better for you. It's going to be a lot easier. And I was just thinking to myself, come on, psych ward. And he was there every day. It was like two weeks in the ICU. My mom came and visited me too, finally. And I felt so ashamed. And she hugged me and she said, it's going to be okay. And my mom and Jeff Wilson were there for me. in the hospital room. And I remember my whole life is just gone, you know. I also remember thinking that, you know, I told the cop I was delivered to come help save puppies and plants. And you know what I mean? And he was just like, is this guy on PCP? And Jeff was just like, no, he hasn't drank any use in like 6 days. And I also remember a priest coming in trying to bless me. And it just didn't work out well. Jeff and the priest didn't get along. It was funny. He was like, Father, you're going to just gonna have to go ahead and leave. We don't really need that right now. And so depressed, so bad, at my bottom. How could it get any worse? I had just tried to kill myself and messed that up. Ruptured both of my intestines. They took 19 feet out of my intestines and sewed everything back up. What if I never play drums again? And Jeff said, you'll be sober. I said, well, what if I'm an axe murderer? And he goes, you'll be a sober axe murderer. Everything I said, like, what if I'd be this? What if I end up like this? What if I end up like that? What if I end up a convict? And he goes, you'll be a sober convict. Sober, 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 sober. We don't drink or use no matter what. I ended up walking, and I remember one day I had the thing with me. I had the wheels on it, and I was walking, and I was looking at this piece of art outside the room. They let me walk, and my mom came and brought me. She said, you know what? I know what's wrong with you. And I was like, what? She goes, you don't have your music. And she gave me this shoebox with the Sony Walkman and cassette tapes, and my tapes were in it, and my headphone was in it. And I put a tape in, and I closed it. And the first song that was on was Africa by Toto. And I remember playing the song and listening to it and walking up to the painting and looking at these mountains on the painting and just dreaming of going to Africa and seeing the mountains and just the trees and how beautiful the green trees look. And I could smell it with the rain and the humidity. And this, like, it took me to Africa. I just let the music just washed over me, and it just started healing me. And it was my music. It was my power. Music is so powerful. And I was like, okay, where is it going to be, jail or the psych ward? And they were like, psych ward. And I was like, sweet. I mean, in comparison to jail, it was way better. So this is my third psych ward. I was in a lockdown unit. And out of my mind, completely out of my mind. My mom had brought in some swim trunks, and there was a razor blade that dropped out of the swim trunks, and nobody saw it, and I put it in my pocket, and I was just like so bad, I was so messed up, that I looked at them and I was like, you guys gotta kinda let me out now. And they were like, no, we're not letting you out. I was like, you need to let me out, you got about an hour, I'm gonna let you have an hour. And they were like, no, Chris, calm down. Go back to your arts and crafts. And I was like, if you don't let me out, you got 45 minutes, you gotta let me out. And they were like, Chris, calm down. 30 minutes, you got 30 minutes left. You gotta let me out or something really bad's gonna happen. And they were like, Chris, just calm down. I was like, you got 15 minutes. You let me out. Let me out of here. You let me out of here now. You have no right to hold me. I know you've got robotic animals out back that are on a schedule and you're programming the messages on the TV and all that. And you better let me out of this. 5 minutes, 4 minutes. I went into the room where they have the straps on the bed and it only goes one way door, and locked the door behind me. I closed the door behind me and I looked out the window, and the medic and the techs came running up to the window and they were looking at me through the window, rushing, trying to get the door open. I held my arm out and I had the razor blade and I said, I told you. And I went, saboom, and slashed my arm open. And I went, saboom, and slashed my arm open again. And arterial spray was just spewing out of my arm. And I said, see what you did. I was out of my mind. And the guys were sewing my arm up. And the guy sewing my arm up was doing it very forcefully and very angrily. And I remember going, whoa, dude, what are you doing? You're a doctor. You're supposed to be healing me. And he was just like, just disgusted, man. He was like, why would you kill yourself? Why would you kill yourself? You know, and I was just like, why wouldn't I? I've got nothing. And Jeff Wilson came to see me. And he was just like, okay, here's what we're going to do. You're going to get on your knees in the morning. And you're going to ask something other than you for help. And I don't care if you say God or not. Doesn't matter. You're going to hit your knees and you're going to ask something other than yourself for help staying clean and sober, to help you not drink or use no matter what. Then you're going to get off your knees and you're going to walk into the direction of recovery no matter what. And I got on my knees and I said, help me, whatever. I stood up and I walked in the direction of recovery and it was horrible. I didn't know how to brush my teeth. I didn't know how to write my name. I couldn't write my name. I was destroyed by drugs and alcohol and out of my mind and psychotic. And I remember thinking to myself, I want to get to the open unit. I want to go where they can let you smoke, you know what I mean? And at that time I smoked cigarettes. And the doctor was nonchalantly looking through the folder going, Chris, how are the AA meetings helping you with your alcoholism? And she said it so nonchalantly. And then all of a sudden when she said that, my life flashed before my eyes and I just went, oh my God, I am totally an alcoholic. I've been an alcoholic and drug addict my whole life. It just made so much sense. And I went to the meetings and I did what Jeff told me. And my mom would come and walk with me out in the grass. And she would say, little by little, day by day, I'm getting better in every way. Say it with me. Little by little, day by day, I'm getting better in every way. And from there, I moved into a sober living house out of that, to the open unit sober living house where they don't have drugs or alcohol. And Jeff had me working on my steps, and I was writing in the fourth step. But I was very upset about the guy I lived with because he had a videotape of aliens and UFOs and unexplained phenomenon. You know, and I could see on the little recorder, there was a dude walking by and a big light shining, and that light went up into the air and it went, and it came back down, and then a dude was walking and the Jeep came and got him, and I was like, oh my God, UFOs exist, they're coming to invade, oh my God. And Jeff said, I called Jeff on the phone, I was like, they're coming to invade, they're coming, UFOs exist. And Jeff said, calm down, I'm gonna be there in 2 hours when I get off work. Just don't drink, don't use, you can stop writing on your fourth step, just get to the backyard, take a breather, drink some water, calm down, deep breaths. I'll be there in about an hour or so, whatever it was. And he ended up showing up in the backyard. He said, okay, what's going on? And I remember sitting there on the curb, my life destroyed, trying to do steps 2 and 3. I admitted there was a God. I admitted there's something bigger. There's a God. Okay, fine, there's a God. Something saved my life on the helicopter. There was something bigger than me. I know, okay, fine, you know. And Jeff was like, hold on, what's the problem? I said, he's got this tape and I saw this guy and the UFOs exist, blah, 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 blah. I'm gonna die, everybody's gonna invade. And Jeff said, calm down, okay, number one, your shoe's untied. Number one, there's a God, right? We agree on that, Chris. And I was like, okay, there's a God. Number two, pay attention. UFOs exist, Chris, I've seen them. And I went, no, and he goes, calm down, calm down. Three, and this is the most important one, Chris, the day that God wants you to have anything to do with a UFO, he'll put one in your life. Until then, tie your shoe and get a job. And he walked away and went back into the house. I finished through that four-step process, an inventory of my life, and put really a deep, deep emotional inventory of all my life. And I went up on a mountain and shared that with him through the fifth step. And through a bunch of tears, I think I had about 3 months sober when I went through that. I came down that mountain and it was like a diesel truck lifted off of my soul. I didn't want to die. I didn't want to die. And for the first time, around 2 to 3 months, I went through an altercation in my sober living house where there was some guys that were going to fight, and it was like this stressful thing. I remember talking to Jeff, my sponsor, about it later after that whole event, and realizing while I was explaining what had happened that day, that I went through that entire altercation, all that drama, without the single thought of, I know what would fix this, another drink, a drug, without the single thought of a drink or a drug. Then I knew, even though I immediately wanted to drink and use again, but I knew for that split moment, I knew it was possible to have this obsession to drink and use removed from me. I knew it was possible because I experienced that. I just hadn't realized that it had happened. It was happening. The higher power, the God, whatever, something bigger than me, took that obsession away from me. through that process of surrendering and acting and taking more action and then showing up every day and then doing the drill. And Jeff used to say all kinds of good stuff to me. He helped me so much. I went through that process and in 6 and 7, which ended up being a continual process I still have to work on today. Step 8, I made a list of these people that I had caused harm to. And then step 9, I went through making amends and showing up. You know, most of those went really good. Most people were like, dude, we're so glad that you're sober now. Right on. I made sober to my friend Mike. I made amends to my friend Mike Blummer of 6 months for a tire that I bought from. I didn't pay him for. And I sent him a money order for $50. And he was just like, wow, man, thanks. I was like, dude, thank you, man. I'm sober. I love you. And he's like, I love you. I'm so glad you're alive. I'm so glad you're alive. We're alive. And this is awesome. We're going to do this. And I was like, cool. I had 9 months sober in the Bishop Gooden home in Pasadena. And I had fallen down many times drunk in a blackout. And this bone right here was up about 2 inches. And it was time to have surgery in recovery. And the doctor was in a 12-step program. And Jeff came up and was there with the doc. He says, Doc, Chris over here is a drug addict and an alcoholic. You're going to have to load him up when you guys put him out. He needs some more than you think. And the doctor was like, we understand that. But he reached up, he leaned down on my bone and squished my shoulder bone down. He said, you know what, I think we can fix that. So they pushed it down and they put 2 big old pins in it to hold the bone there. I came out of surgery just really high on the morphine, whatever those drugs are. I came out of surgery, I was in a wheelchair. My mom and Jeff were in the room. And Jeff came up to me and said, hey, Chris, how you feeling? And I was like, I'm feeling really good, man. I love you, man. I love you, Jeff. I really love you, man. And he was like, I know, buddy. I love you, too. But here's the thing. The doc came up and told us that in about an hour or so, you're going to feel like a horse ripped your arm off. So we're going to have to get ready for that. And I was like, I'm fine. I'm fine. And pretty soon my shoulder started hurting. And then it started hurting worse. And pretty soon this pain got more and more and more and more. And pretty soon it was just completely unbearable. I was like, oh my God. My eyes were rolling in the back of my head. I was on the wheelchair in so much pain. I passed out. I left that hospital. And I said, I don't care. I'll do that. I'm clean and sober. I'm straight. I'm clean and sober. I will not use your medications. I will not use your drugs. I'm clean and sober now. I don't take anything to get high. And the only, you know, it's bad enough that I got high on the medication when you, you know, got me surgery. But now it's it. I'm not gonna take that anymore. I don't do drugs. And they said, Chris, please take these drugs home. We know exactly what you're talking about, but we made these drugs to help you deal with pain and heal. So take these drugs. And I was like, no, I'm not taking the drugs. And then the doctor was like, we think you should take the drugs because if you don't, you could end up in the hospital emergency room and then we're going to shoot you up with even more drugs if that happens. So why don't you just go ahead and take these? And I was like, nope. And Jeff was just like, hey, man, you know, you have to make your own decisions here. So if you don't want to do them, I can't stop you. My suggestion is take the drugs. And I was like, no, I'm clean and sober. I'm not going to take drugs. 4 hours later, my friend Tom Tookie was racing down the highway from the sobriety house. He was racing down the highway, taking me to the emergency room because I was dying and I couldn't handle it. And we went to the emergency room and they immediately shot me up with something. And I remember going, oh, Tom, I love you, man. And he was like, dude, I love you too. And I was like, oh my God. Anyway, that happened. But I'm still allowed to keep my recovery date because it wasn't like I went seeking it, you know. And I went through that time in the Bishop Gooden home, and they saved my life through just bringing meetings in and people that were successful. One guy, they came in, had about 4 years of recovery, had a nice suit on, a Cadillac, and he shared in front of this group of young men, which I was a part of, and he said, you know what, guys, this is possible. You can be an alcoholic and stay sober. You can be a drug addict and make it in this world. You can still do this. Your odds are against you, but you can do this. Just decide right now that you're going to be that one. You're going to be that percent. You're just going to be, it's going to be you right now, today, that makes it. And I remember thinking to myself, I'm going to make it. Just, I don't know about tomorrow, today, right now. And I really started to live one day at a time at that point. My 10th step was a continued process. I kept doing that. My 11th step, you know what? I'm still working on the 11th step. My 12th step was about, you know, bringing this message to others. And I started doing that with Jeff. We would go on 12-step calls together. And I remember during that time, too, that Jeff Wilson, I was in his car, and I had the seatbelt on. And he drove this old Volvo at that time, Volvo or something like that at the time. And we were behind a bus on the street. And he goes, he leaned over. He was like, "Chris, step back." And he put his hand on my chest and he said, "This one's mine." And he floored the car towards the bus. And my feet went up on the dashboard. "No." And he stopped the car. He was laughing his face off. And I was like, "Oh my God. Oh my God." He was just laughing. He had so much fun. This guy had so much fun, man. It was hilarious. It really was funny. It's like, "This is mine." I got to a year of clean time. With sober, a year clean and sober, and he gave me my chip across the street at this group home, and there was a crowd of people, and he held the chip up and he said, "All right, Chris, the party's over, it's time to get to work." And everybody like agreed in recovery. They're like, "Yeah, party's over, the first year's a gift, it's time to get to work." And he leaned into me, handed the chip, and he leaned into my ear and he said, "I'm just kidding. Just started." And it was two nights ago, something like that. We were at the porch, on the porch at Bishop Gooden, and he said, "I want you to take out a piece of paper. Let's get a pen." And we took out a piece of paper and a pen. And he said, "I want you to imagine your wildest dreams. I want you to think about what you always wanted. Deep in your heart, what do you really desire? And I want you to dream really big. Dream really big, Chris. I'm going to write you a blank check and give it to you. Money means nothing. We have all the money in the world. What are you going to do?" And immediately I just wrote down, "I'm going to have a monster truck. I'm going to have drumsticks with my name on them and people will buy them. I'm going to tour the world. I'm going to be a professional musician. And yeah, and I'm going to have a green dually." And he said, "Okay, that was pretty good. That's good." And he folded up the paper and we put it in an envelope and sealed it. And he said, "Now I'm going to tell you what they don't say in the big book. If you continue to do this deal and you do not drink and use, and you continue to give this message and carry this message to others who suffer, just be of service. If you continue to do this deal, one day at a time, suit up and show up, you know, when the shit hits the fan, unplug the fan. When you do this deal and help other people do this deal, if you keep doing this and stay clean and sober one day at a time, you'll look back within 5 years at that list and you will have sold yourself short." I was touring Europe with Mr. Boogie Woogie, and it was just incredible. I've had signature drumsticks and signature snare drums and been all over the place playing drums. I could bore you for hours about what I've done since and the things that have come true in my life since and the blessings I've received from just being clean and sober and being part of that community. And you know, like today, what it's like now, I wake up, I hit my knees, and I say something like to the effect of something other than myself. I pray to God and I say, "God, thanks for keeping me sober last night. Please have me stay sober tomorrow." I kind of like hedge my bets all the time. And "May thy will be done, not mine." And I get up and I move. I try to walk into the direction of recovery and sobriety. Life has been life. It's happened to be up and down. Really great things have happened in my life and really bad things have happened in my life. But I have not had to drink or use because of it, because of that that connection I have. And Jeff Wilson saved my life. And he did that by showing me a way of living that demands rigorous honesty But can be done. If you're willing to do whatever it takes right now to not drink or use, you can have whatever you want in your life. And if nothing else, you'll definitely have a way out of suicide. You do not need to kill yourself. There's a way out. I don't know why I got to stay clean and sober and so many other friends of mine have died. I don't know why I'm so lucky. I know that I can't wear a watch ever since I was on the out of my body on the helicopter. I don't know why, but I stopped watch batteries. My mom was just like, yeah, whatever. I had moved back with her after a failed mission with the metal band in 98, something like that. Right before I got on the cruise ship, I moved back to my mom's house with my tail between my legs, you know, and I was going to start auditioning in LA more and do that and try to do the drumming thing again. And my mom was like, you know what, your watches are stopping because you're wearing the watches your dad buys you that have Philadelphia Eagles on them that he pays $5 in the mail for, you know, and you're wearing really low quality watches. That's why your battery's stopping. And I was like, oh yeah? All right, fine. Well, let's get a good watch. And she was like, you know what? We get a $100 watch. She bought me a $100 watch. We put it on my wrist. And said, all right, stop that one. And then, like, I went to bed. I'm reading a book a little bit before bed. I don't know how long it was. I learned over the watch was dead. And I went down. I said, see? And my mom was like, I'll be damned. And then it wasn't like 2 weeks later, she was like yelling about the hallway. She's like, all of my batteries are dead. And I was like, I don't know. To this day, I haven't figured that out. I wish I could, somebody watching knows anything about that, could tell me why I kill small batteries. And is that a superpower I can figure out how to win the lottery with? Because that would be really cool. But yeah, the moral to the story here for me is that I'm eternally grateful for the people in recovery that saved my life. And I am eternally grateful for my mother, who did nothing but love me my whole life. And my brother, who did nothing but love me for his whole life. And so far he's doing that still. I love you, Ken. I love my friends. I love you, Heather, my fiance. I can't wait to see what the future holds. It's gonna be amazing. And if you're in need of help, reach out. Ask. Thank you. God bless you. Have a great day.
Longing for some solitary company. I know that I must do what's right. Sure as Kilimanjaro rises like Olympus above the Serengeti. I seek to cure what's deep inside, frightened of this thing that I've become.